to congratulate Zezima, all our colleagues, collaborators, and the students who have been developing a so good work all during these years. Naming Ana Maria Godfard and Vera, who now is the chair of the graduate course. Vera is here. Okay. I think that I would like to say about the courage, the dedication, and the quality of the work they have developed. And also, I would like to thank for inviting me to participate in this celebration. As Stephen said, we are coming from China, Mexico, ancient Mexico, Egypt, ISIS, and now Stephen has prepared, we are going to complex systems and to complex thought. This work we have developed in collaboration with several people. We have, during several years, an interdisciplinary research group on the theory of systems, self-organization, and information at the Center for Logic, Epistemology, and the History of Science of my university, the State University of Campinas, and also with the collaboration of some engineers, colleagues of the Federal University of ABC, do ABC, we are developing some results relative to the impacts of the technology of information in philosophy, the arts, and the sciences. And this, we decided together, I will present you some basic concepts we have introduced in order to continue working with several people coming from different areas of knowledge. At the beginning of our work, several years ago, we saw that it is very difficult to work by using terms which are not common to the distinct areas of knowledge. As I am a logician, I tried to fix some concepts in order to present some basic definitions. And nowadays, when we speak about systems, about self-organization, about complex systems, we in general know which are our basis or foundational concepts. And now I'm trying to give some idea. The objective of my presentation is to discuss some basic concepts of the theory of self-organizing systems and complex systems. But today, even discussing with the students the posters, there are several works that can be approached from this point of view, from the point of systemics way of trying to understand the questions. A complex system, according to Mitchell and Newman, is a group of organization which is made up of many interacting parts. In such systems, the individual parts, called components or agents or elements, and the interactions between them often lead to large-scale behaviors which are not easily predicted from a knowledge only of the behavior of the individual agents. But when we speak about systems, complex systems, the first question is, what is a system? In general, we speak about system, structure, infrastructure, substructure, without explaining about which we are speaking. And so we decided to present a suggestion. We are using it. A system is a structure with functionality. We have structures, but a structure is not a system. What is a structure? According to a definition presented by Tarski in the years 1940, Tarski, Alfred Tarski, the logician, this is the classical definition of structure. A structure is a non-empty set with relations. Let's see. In order to have a structure, we must have a set. We call it universe set or domain. Non-empty because we need the elements, components of the basic domain. The elements can be called agents, components. We must have a set, a non-empty set, elements, but we must have relations among the elements of the set. Here we have a structure. For instance, if I'm working with a crystal, I have a structure, but a crystal is not a system. In order to be a system, a structure must have a functionality. A functionality comprehends the functions the structure will develop. I used to say that the functionality, it's very difficult to define. The functionality of a system is a kind of informational directionality of the system. The way he will work, he will happen in the process he will develop. Systems are connected to processes. Okay, structure. In order to have a structure, we have a domain and relations. And so, the domain, the set of elements and of components of the system. The properties and the behavior of every element of a system, of the structure, which is the basis of the system, the properties and the behavior of every element affects the whole system. That is, in a system, there is no isolated element. In a structure, you may have isolated elements, but in a system, it's not possible to have isolated elements. Sometimes, during some periods, we may think that some element is isolated, but if it belongs to the universe, to the domain of a system, it is not isolated. Even if it seems isolated, its presence has a very important significance for the system. Relations. We must have relations. They need a determined or undetermined, but the elements are submitted to certain restrictions even when the relation is not determined. Which are these restrictions? Their basic history in the system, their basic functions in the system. The relations of the system originate an important systemic characteristic, its organization. The organization of a system, more or less, is the same thing when I say this system and its organization. In general, people say this system is ordered. No, the system has not an order, it has an organization. The system is ordered when one of its relations is an order relation, according to the logical mathematical laws, definitions. And so systems are organized, not ordered. In the literature in general, people write ordered. They say order parameter, but I don't like it. Let's remember, given a system, subsets, parts of the domain with specific relations between among its elements may be substructures of the original structure. And in a system, substructures, if they have their proper functionality, subsets may be substructures, and substructures may be subsystems. Think about the human body. We have a system, but we may have substructures that are subsystems. For instance, the visual subsystem, for instance. Okay, this is interesting because we may have subsystems in a system. Systems. Systems are objects that must be conceived by a subject. There are not systems without observers. The observer, the subject, may participate in the universe, may be an element of the universe of the system, of the domain of the system, but the subject may be an external object. The characteristics of the systems do not correspond to the simple union or addition of the characteristics of their parts. In a structure may be simply the union of the substructures. But in order to have a system, the system has something more than simply the union of its parts. This is a property very important called synergy of systems. The characteristics of the systems may be considered as emergences of the system. And another very important property of a system is its globality with the possibility of novelty in systems. When you consider systems, when the observer considers a system, the system is in a context. We have a universe of observation. This universe characterizes the domain of the system and what is out of the domain. What is out of the domain is the environment of the system. From the logical point of view, the environment is the complementary part, complementary of the system relative to the universe of thinking. Okay, in order to establish concepts, I tried to transfer to the language and to the theory of systems, I tried to transfer some topological notions. And then, by using topological notions, by considering the environment as a complement of the domain of the system relative to the universe, we can characterize the interior of the system, the elements which characterize the interior. We can characterize the exterior, but we can characterize a very important set of elements, the frontier of the system. But we are characterizing distinctly from topological theory, characterizing not by open sets, but by relation. An element belongs to the frontier of the system if every one of the relations maintained by the elements involve elements of the domain of the structure of the system and elements of the environment. That is, a frontier point is a point for which every relation he maintains necessarily involves points from inside and from outside. That is, the frontier points are very important because they are the points through which the system maintain contacts and relations with the environment. And from this definition, we can define interior point, exterior, and not go in details. But usually people think this system is closed. And so you think the system does not maintain relations with the exterior. According to this definition, a system is closed when all its frontier points belong to the domain of the system. And so a system may be closed without being isolated. Okay? Don't worry. Forget that. A system is a structure, and so a structure is a pair constituted by a universe non-empty and by a set of relations, Rj, with functionality. The J belongs to big J, but you will see, I'm going on, that we don't deal with static systems, because we are thinking about big data, complex systems. We need structures that can develop in the process, and this is the I. The universe, the domain of the structure, also can change because the relations can change. We have no determinate relations to, and they may develop during the process concerning the functionality of the system. And then we have changes in a system when we have changes in the behavior of the relations, or when we have change in the domain of the relation. Some points, which are frontier points, may become external points. Some points of the environment may become internal points. The subject, the observer, may become part of the system during the observation. Okay. The novelty of the definition now is that we do not use the classical notion of structure. We very recently, I have the idea to use a concept introduced by Newton da Costa in 1986, that is the concept of partial truth for Newton da Costa. There is no truth in science, only partial truths that he calls quasi-truth. But in order to define his concept of his pragmatic partial truth, he introduced a special kind of structure he called partial structures, where we have an ordered part, as I previously projected, the domain and relations. D is not empty, but the relations are not relations in the classical view. They are what Newton da Costa calls partial relation. Don't read, it's not necessary. You know what's a relation. A binary relation is a set of ordered pairs. When I say AB belongs to a relation, it means that A is in the relation with B. But for Newton da Costa, for every good relation, instead of knowing only that some point satisfies the relation, he claims, in general, in order to good relations, we have points who belong to the relation, points that do not belong, and points relative to which we do not know whether they belong to us or not. And so, for us, a system is a partial structure because it has domains and partial relations. Because I need relations that can change during the process, the functionality of the system. The relations may change with the possibility of self-organization. Sometimes we have an emergence of the system. This emergence may be a new product or even the result of a process of organizational transformation. When we have this, we have creation in the system. But if you have a sequence of organizational innovations, this characterizes what we call a creative evolution. And so, for us, systems are partial structures with a universe set relations which characterize the structure. The structure, in the way with a functionality, characterize the system, which equivalently characterize an organization. We have a subject, an environment, we may have self-organization, creation, and evolution. Okay, in order to deal with these so difficult systems, with self-organization, creation, evolution, we are dealing with complex systems. But in order to characterize the complex systems paradigm, our main presuppositions are, we need a multiple scale analysis, Stephen, you are having it, self-organization, emergence, and circular causation. In order to have self-organization emergence, we must have circular causation. The multiple scale dynamics of complex systems. Multiple scale dynamics is an inherent characteristic of complex systems. Ideally, complex systems should be investigated from inter and transdisciplinary perspectives. Self-organization, a major characteristic of complexity. According to Ashby, von Foster, Hacken, Debran, Cohen, and Kelso, a process through which new forms of organization emerge solely from the dynamic interaction among elements initially independent, without any a priori plan or central controller, this is a process with self-organization. It allows for consideration of many levels of dependency of human existence. But we have assumed the definition presented by the founder of our interdisciplinary group, Michel Debran. There is self-organization every time that the appearance or the restructuring of a form throughout a certain process is due to the process itself and to its intrinsic characteristics, and only to a lesser degree to its initial conditions, to the interchange with the environment or to the causal presence of a supervising instance. Emergent property of the dynamical interaction amongst elements of the micro level characterize what in the literature is called order parameter. I prefer order organization. When the parameters emerge at the macro level, they enslave the behavior of the individual elements, producing new characteristics at the macroscopic scale. What's emergence? A process involving many levels of dependency of interacting elements in a self-organizing system. We, with circular causation, the complexity, we have the complexity of systems. The emergence is not simply a function of the interactions, the relations between many components, but of their organization. The organization of complex systems is not static or complete. We have, when we have circular causation, we have top-down causation and bottom-up causation. An example, very simple, of qualitative analysis and foraging consists of bottom-up explorations by ants moving at random, looking for food in any direction, and top-down explorations in which ants follow existing pheromone trails. Okay, this is a picture and about complexity or the parameter and self-organization. We began studying self-organization in order to identify self-organization in social environment, in social phenomena, because in chemistry, in physics, In mathematics, we have the theory of dynamical systems, and in chemistry, we had Prigogine, and in physics, in other areas, but in social sciences, it's very difficult to discover phenomena or areas of knowledge studied and analyzed from a complex point of view and from the complex systems approach. And we think that this kind of analysis from self-organization is very important. There are authors that claim that it's not necessary to have self-organization in order to characterize a complex system. We are considering that it's necessary because we must have circular causation, and it's very difficult to understand the behavior of complex systems without analyzing and identifying self-organization. And we think that in complex systems, the interesting thing is that we can't have prediction with the emergence of things according to the interaction of the elements of the system and with the environment, we may have very interesting surprises.